Good afternoon, Saints. This is Robin Kirby-Gatto. Welcome to today's live. It is going to be phenomenal. Oh my goodness. We are going to do communion. Holy Spirit is going to strengthen us. It is the time of Pesach, Passover. Amen. So as you join on, you be hopeful and expectant. Holy Spirit is going to strengthen you. Amen. Hey, Eva, God bless you. Thank you for joining in. Hey, thank you for joining in Jesus' name. Hey, William, so good to see you. Hey, Amber Tucker, God bless you. Thank y'all for joining in Jesus' name. Somebody just tried to call me from Facebook Messenger. Hey, Joanne Morgan, I love you. Hey, Renee. Hey, Dina, I love y'all. Hey, Gina, God bless you. Thank you for joining in. It is going to be a super awesome day. Amen. Happy Passover. Hey, there's another Gina. God bless you. It is going to be so super awesome. Hey, Tracy Hancock. Love you, lady. It is going to be such a blessing. We are going to enter into God's word. We're going to enter into God's truth. And I don't know about y'all, but I have been having such a super blessed Passover. It is such an awesome time. We are in the time where we're leading up to Passover this evening as it begins at sundown. And for Rich and I, we've been to a few Seders, but we have our Seder plate, Pesach, ready that we are so super excited. We have the elements put away in the fridge, and we're going to be so super excited about doing that this evening. One of the favorite things that Rich and I love doing for Passover is watching, of course, Passion of the Christ and doing Passover. And so if some of y'all don't know what to do tonight, if you want to celebrate the Jewish calendar Passover, Pesach, it is an awesome time to do it and watch Passion of the Christ. Amen. Hey, April, God bless you. Hey, Mary, so good to see you on here. And we're going to get into actually communion today. And so I've got the bread that I'm going to break a piece off of and briefly get into this for a moment. And then I've got the vine of the grape that I'm going to get in, and I've already had my lips on it and been drinking some water. So we're going to get into that as well. And God is just going to bring us into a deeper anointing of grace, of power, of strength. Hey, Steve, God bless you, brother. Thank you for joining in. And we're going to see Holy Spirit just bring such an anointing of a fresh anointing, a new anointing. I see you, Donna. God bless you. Thank you for joining in. It's so funny because I see people from Louisiana, from Ohio, and of course from Alabama, from places where I've gone to minister live. And I so super love y'all all. Thank y'all for joining in. And so we're going to get started with prayer. Amen. So as you come together, we're going to get started in prayer. And then God is going to have me get into a teaching. And then we're going to get into communion. Amen. God, we just thank you for your Holy Spirit. We thank you, Father, that you have brought us to such a time where we celebrate the work of the cross of Christ Jesus, and that we enter into a time of your truth as you cause us to be under that Hebrews 4:12 anointing, glory to God, where you bring your double-edged sword in our hearts to divide between soul and spirit, between intent and motive, and that you strengthen us in this truth. And we're going to be so refreshed by the word of truth that comes in your mighty power. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, Jenny Gailey, I love you. Hey, Dinah, so good to see you. Hey, Jean, God bless you. Hey, Michelle Will. Hey, Australia. Hey, Canada. Hey, Shirley, so good to see you. Hold on 1 second. And so we're going to start actually in the Gospel of John, amen. God had me in the Gospel of John because I was asking the Lord, as he brought this message, understand that this is going to be the message that God has for you on this broadcast. There are a lot of saints that are giving out such meat today as we enter into Passover, And as we approach to Resurrection Day, which will actually be on our Friday on the Jewish calendar, and so I will not do Facebook Live tomorrow, but I will do a resurrection message on Friday. So today it is going to be about the cross, and then on Friday it is going to be about Christ's resurrection, amen? And so one of the things that the Father was telling me is He said, Robin, I want you to go to John. I want you to minister out of the Gospel of John, and we're going to actually look at John 19. John 19, and we're going to start at verse 13. And we're going to read John 19 to the end of the chapter. And then God is going to take us deeper as we visit Gilgal. Remember, I've been talking about Gilgal for the last 2 weeks as it relates to purity, holiness. And so today, God is going to take us to Gilgal after the message of John 19, before we do communion, because saints, it is about us yielding ourselves to Holy Spirit as we submit ourselves in humility to the Father, and that He does a great work. And as He does a great work, oh my goodness, that anointing of Holy Spirit and fire, that anointing of the oil of gladness will come upon you. It will strengthen you, and you will have the fresh anointing, amen? Especially in this hour where we find ourselves in a time which is known as quarantine. God is going to bring a greater revelation. And also, I really feel led by Holy Spirit to pray over the doorpost of the home. And so for those of y'all who feel led, use your olive oil and anoint your doorpost and just plead the blood of Jesus, amen? And I truly believe as we walk in obedience to what the Father has called us to do in this hour, that He is just going to do Ephesians 3:20, exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we can think or imagine, according to that power of His Holy Spirit that is at operation inside of us. Amen, Renee did it. Amen, Donna. Amen. I just really feel in my spirit, I have not been this excited about any Passover to the degree that I am super excited about this Passover. There is something that is very special about this Passover. And so as we get ready to look at John 19, I want to actually get into this word because God keeps bringing it up to me. And He wants me to bring it up in the dictionary. And so let's look at this word quarantine. Quarantine means a state or period of isolation in which people, and it also references animals, have arrived from elsewhere or been exposed to an infectious or contagious disease. It actually comes from the Italian word quaranta, which means 40. Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. I did not know that. Amen, Gina. You're going to get it today in Jesus' name. Oh my goodness. Quarantine means 40. Are we like super excited? Because why? Because after Israel had been in the wilderness, how many years? 40, which represents testing, God caused them to cross over the Jordan. I know, Dina, is that not crazy? Over the Jordan. Amen, Brittany. Over the Jordan. And God began to bring them into a place of a deeper circumcision of their heart. And this is what we're going to look at as we look at Joshua 5 today. Before, amen, Jessica. Good for you, sister. Before they took the land, they were at Gilgal. Is that not mind-blowing? Amen, Andrea. That quarantine means 40. So we are going to see that flipped, and it's going to work to our good. And we are going to come out of the wilderness leaning on our beloved. Woo! In Jesus' name. Amen, Sue Gailey. And so we're going to start at John 19, and we're going to start with verse 13. Amen. Hearing this, Pilate brought Jesus out and sat down on the judgment seat at a place called the pavement, the mosaic pavement, the stone, the platform, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation for the Passover, and it was about the sixth hour, about 12 o'clock noon. Woo! For some of y'all, it is 12 o'clock. Is that not amazing? He said to the Jews, "See, here is your king. Here is your king." But they shouted, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but Caesar." Then he delivered him, Jesus, over to them to be crucified. And they took Jesus and led him away. So he went out bearing his own cross. So to the spot called the place of the skull. In Hebrew, it was called Golgotha. Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, and Jesus between them. And Pilate also wrote a title, an inscription on a placard, and put it on the cross. And the writing was, "Jesus the Nazarene, King of the Jews." And many of the Jews read this title, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city. And it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and in Greek. Then the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write the King of the Jews." But he said, "I am the King of the Jews." And this is what Jesus said to Pilate, and Pilate's acknowledging this. Amen. Pilate replied, "What I have written, I have written." Then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garments and made four parts, one share for each soldier, and also the tunic, a long shirt-like undergarment. But the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top throughout. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but let us cast lots to decide whose it shall be." They parted my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. So the soldier did these set things according to Psalm 22:18. But by the cross of Jesus stood his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. So Jesus, seeing his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing near her, said to his mother, "Dear woman, see, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "See, here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own keeping, his own home. And after this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, ended, said in fulfillment of the scripture, "I thirst." A vessel jar full of sour wine vinegar was placed there, so that they put a sponge soaked in the sour wine on a stalk reed of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished." And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Since it was the day of preparation, in order to prevent the bodies from hanging on the cross on Sabbath, for the Sabbath was a very solemn and important one, the Jews requested Pilate to have legs broken and the bodies taken away. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first one and on the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and they saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and immediately blood, woo, and water, hallelujah, blood and water came and flowed out. And he who saw it The eyewitnesses gives this evidence, and his testimony is true. And he knows and he tells the truth that you may believe it also. For these scriptures took place that the scripture might be fulfilled, verified, carried out. Woo! In Jesus' name, not one of these bones shall be broken. And again, another scripture says, they shall look on him whom they have pierced. And after this, Joseph of Arimathea, a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate to let him take the body away of Jesus. And Pilate granted him permission. So he came and took away his body. And Nicodemus also, who first had come to Jesus by night. Woo! Thank you, Jesus. Nicodemus, who first came to Jesus by night, came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes weighing about 100 pounds. So they took Jesus' body, they bound it in linen cloths and with spices, aromatics, as is the Jews' customary way to prepare for burial. Now there was a garden. There was a garden in the place where he was crucified, and the garden a new tomb. Woo! In which no one had yet ever been laid. So there, because of the Jewish day of preparation, and since the tomb was near, they laid Jesus. Now, oh my goodness, I'm telling you, saints, there is a grace on this text of scripture from John 19, verse 13, all the way to verse 42, as God had me read it. And what we're seeing the emphasis of is the crucifixion of Christ. The crucifixion of Christ. And as we look at this, saints of God, we're going to get a little deeper and get into a Greek word or two, because Holy Spirit wants to bring you understanding. Why? Because there's some of y'all who have to lay your sins down at the cross. Down at the cross. There's some of you that do not realize that you're still holding on to sin. And God is going to remove that from your person today. He is going to deliver you. He is going to set you free by the power of Holy Spirit. And John 8:32, you shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. And you are going to walk in freedom today as Holy Spirit brings a grace to uproot, to tear down, to destroy the works of darkness, of evil, and to bring the power of the light, where the light pierces the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. It cannot put it out. Amen? In Jesus' name. And so when we look at scripture, and I'm actually also looking at King James Version, because one of the things that I really enjoy doing is crossing the Amplified Classic with a King James Version, because I want to make sure the word is accurately divided. And so when we look at scripture right here, I want to get to the place where in John 19, in the King James Version, where the sponge that had the vinegar was lifted up to his mouth, because that's really important for me. So let's look at verse 20 and 29. Now there was a vessel full of vinegar, and they filled a sponge with vinegar and put it up to his mouth with hyssop, that it had hyssop, and they put it up to his mouth. When Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, "It is finished." And this is what we're going to look at in a greater measure, because one of the areas in which we are going to deal with is the receiving of the vine of the grape, the blood of Jesus Christ. Because Jesus drank from a cup of suffering. And that cup, where we see the sponge, that it became a cup of sort, and it had vinegar. And that means bitter. And that vinegar represents bitter fountains. that are flowing in this present age in the world. And that is where persecution of the saints come from. That is where the persecution of Jesus Christ came from. It was from the bitter fountains of the religious that had crucified him. But understand this, saints of God, because he loved them. He loved them. He said even about those that were crucifying him, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And that is actually in Luke 23:34, where Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And that is also the scene of the crucifixion. And we have to get to this point in this life, in this moment, hallelujah, where we are willing to lay down our lives, where we love our life not even to death. We lay it down and we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Revelation 12:11. And God is preparing his church. And there is going to be a greater cutting in this hour, a circumcision. And God is going to get to that bitter root in us where there is any appropriation of the enemy and operation in order that we can just lay it down at the cross. Lay it down at the cross because, saints of God, there is a deeper healing that Holy Spirit is bringing you from the Father today. And God is telling me that some of you are going to experience supernatural healing, supernatural deliverance. The first sign that the kingdom of heaven has come is that devils are cast out. That is the first sign that the kingdom of heaven has come is that devils are cast out. And there is so much oppression that has been being surfaced in this hour that might have been an undercurrent in our soul before this quarantine. Woo! 40 days trying, testing. If some of y'all are experiencing what you feel like is the manifestation of unlovely behaviors, it is because it is a spiritual quarantine, a testing and trying of the word that is in you that is being persecuted. And it is bringing things up to the surface that have been hidden. And why is this necessary? Because, saints of God, Ephesians 3:20 says that God is able. He is able to do exceedingly, abundantly above all that you can think or imagine, according to that power. Woo! That's in operation where? Inside of you, inside of your temple. And remember, Holy Spirit moves through our emotions. And so when we have hindrances in us of bitterness, of unforgiveness, when we have those hindrances, the Holy Spirit can't move in the dimension that the Father wants Holy Spirit to do exceedingly, abundantly, above what we can think or imagine. And this is the crossover. This is the Gilgal, the circumcision. And Jesus partaking, as it looks like that vinegar sponge was lifted up to him. Now, I remember one scripture, it looked like in one of the Gospels, I think it might have been Luke, where it did not show him partaking of it, but particularly in John 19, it shows that he partook of it. But actually, that vinegar represents that bitter drink. And also with Israel, when we look at the Pesach and the Passover, the Seder plate, when we look at this, It has got horseradish in the middle, and it's also got bitter herbs, and that is to keep us in remembrance of what happened in Egypt as they got ready to come out. And as we look at Jesus on the cross and we see this vinegar, this sponge, it is to let us know, woo! You are crossing over from death and you're crossing into life. Jesus paid the price. He finished it. It took one man, Son of God, Son of Man, Jesus Christ. He finished it. And he didn't walk into a tabernacle on earth. He crossed over into heaven's tabernacle and he put his own blood on the mercy seat. And saints, when we are in that place and we find within our self-image, within our soul, mixed emotions and downcast, and we're not sure what's going on in these emotions, what's going on in this temple, Holy Spirit brings a quarantine. He brings a 40-day. Woo! Because do you understand? They could not go to Gilgal until the men of war who had been in the wilderness, until they had died. And God is saying today that something in you needs to be crucified. Something in me, hallelujah. God is cutting us for us to go deeper with his word so that we can get real, so that we can confess our sins, hallelujah, and if necessary, to one another, because there is freedom in that. You shame the devil. You put him under your feet when you walk in that liberty, in that expression, amen. And so as we take John 19, we're now going to transition into Joshua 5, into Joshua 5. And oh my goodness, you are going to see something so amazing, amen. Joshua 5, and God is going to bring John 19, and he is going to show us a greater strength in Joshua 5. Because some of you are bearing your cross. You pick up your cross and you follow Christ. You pick up your cross and follow Christ. That's what Jesus said in Matthew 16, 24 through 26. Take up your cross and follow me. And that means that we are going to have to take to our cross where we are picking up and we're following Christ, that we are willing to go to Gilgal. We are willing to go to Hebrews 4:12, to that operation table where we lay ourselves on that table and say, God, cut me up with your word. Divide between my intents, my motives. I don't even know what's in my heart, God, but you do. And saints, I did not know what message I was going to bring you today. I am telling you everything that I am speaking. I am hearing it just a millisecond before I speak it to you. And God is going to remove oppression, depression, suicide, dis-ease, bitterness, pride, rejection, fear. He's going to remove it by the Spirit of the Lord. And he's going to cut into you with his word, and it is going to uproot. It is going to tear down. Woo! And it is going to destroy, and you're going to be filled with the power of Holy Spirit. And you're going to know holiness, and you're going to feel the cleansing presence of God. And you're going to know it's not by your power, it's not by your might, but it is by God's Spirit. Woo! In Jesus' name. So let's go to Joshua 5, and let's see when they cross over to Gilgal. Amen. Joshua 5, verse 1. When all the kings of the Amorites who are beyond the Jordan to the west, and all the kings of the Canaanites who were by the sea, heard the Lord had dried up the waters of the Jordan. And isn't it interesting? Because Jordan means to descend. Woo! We have to go lower. We are getting ready. We are getting ready for Passover. Do you understand this message is to get you ready for what is to come? Ever since last Friday and ever since my dream 2 years ago, in my dream, God reset the time. And God is going to give you a reset, and He is going to bring Holy Spirit and fire. He is going to renew your strength, and He is going to give you a fire, a passion for your first love. And you're going to return to your first love, amen, those that need it, amen. Verse 1, when all the kings of the Amorites who are beyond the Jordan to the west and all the kings of the Canaanites who are by the sea heard the Lord had dried up the waters of the Jordan before the Israelites until we had crossed over, their hearts melted and there was no spirit in them anymore because of the Israelites. Do you understand? When you are Ezekiel 37:10 and you come out of your tomb and you stand up a great army, it says in verse 11, Ezekiel 37, they said, our hope has been cut off. Do you understand? They were an army, but they could not go forward into their marching orders because they said, our hope has been cut off. And some of y'all, your hope has been cut off, and God is going to renew and reset and restore your hope. That when you get this hope, remember, if you've seen the Keys of the Kingdom, part 6 and 7, you will see that actually the Keys of the Kingdom is Christ in us, the hope of glory. Woo! And when you understand how powerful, how terrible of a weapon of destruction hope is against the devil, oh my goodness, we are going to see an outpouring, revival of Holy Spirit. And we are going to be fearless. We are not going to believe the report of the enemy. We only have one report, and that is Christ has risen. It is well with my soul. God is good. He is faithful. He always provides according to His riches and glory. Not ours, not our job, not other people. God provides according to His riches and glory. Amen. Now let's go to verse 2. At that time, the Lord said to Joshua, make knives of flint and circumcise the new generation of Israelites that as before. So Joshua made knives of flint and circumcised the son of Israel at Gilbeath Haraloth. Now, saints, before we get into this, understand that God is showing you what picking up your cross, what you picking up your cross and following Christ. We are looking at Christ's work on the cross, and we are doing according to what He told us. We are picking up our cross, and we are following Him. Amen. And so this is what Joshua 5 reveals. So let's look particularly at the place in which they were at when they went through this circumcision. We see this place actually in Joshua 5. It is the place in verse 3 called Gibeath Haraloth. Gibeath Haraloth. Now, I know I'm not saying that word so incredible, but it's Gibeath Haraloth, and it's at that place where circumcision occurs. But this is what we're going to get into, because remember, our circumcision is not circumcision of the flesh, but circumcision of the heart. And that is actually Romans 2, 25 through 29. Our circumcision is the circumcision of the heart. Amen. And for this reason, Joshua circumcised, verse 3, so Joshua made knives of flint and circumcised the son of Israel at Gibeath Haraloth. And it is this reason that Joshua circumcised them. It is this reason. Are you ready? All the males of the people who came out of Egypt, all the men of war, had died in the wilderness on the way after they came out of Egypt. Now understand this. It is not until you get your circumcision in your heart in a deeper measure. And you're saying, Robin, I've been in the wilderness. I've come out. We're going to find out, as I mentioned on the last broadcast, and I mentioned about in my 6 notes on a heart transplant at Gilgal, is that Joshua, when he went off to battle, he came back to Gilgal. He camped at Gilgal. Why? Because he had the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, which was what? War, battle. We were never created for that. We were created for life and life abundantly. And so that knowledge had worn him down. And God knew the reproach of the enemy would get on him, and that represents the wilderness. Saints of God, your wilderness is the place of circumcision. And when you are circumcised, hallelujah, and brought into a greater liberty, you're coming out of your wilderness. And we see as Jesus in Matthew 4, he came out in power. And that is where Holy Spirit is moving us into that power, amen. So let's look at verse 6. For the Israelites walked 40 years. Or can we say, they were in a long quarantine. You think our quarantine is hard? Now remember the word quarantine in Italian, quaranta, means 40. And so, where do you think they might have gotten that number from? Is that not crazy? Because the Israelites were quarantined for 40 years in the wilderness. Why? Because of the message of Egypt, the message of sin, the message of fear. And saints of God, this quarantine that you and I are physically under, it is to let us know that we have been in a wilderness in some area of our life, and God is bringing us out. He is delivering us because I refuse to not have faith. I refuse to stay subjugated to the fear of this issue that is in our world, that is on all the media, that is being hyped, and it is trying to bring in the message of the Nephilim, and I will not receive it. I will not listen to it because that is fear. That is the evil report, and I choose to be like Joshua. I choose to be like Caleb and to know that God is our deliverer and he has a plan, amen? And saints of God, this is where you are. You are in this moment at Passover for God to show you your wilderness so that you're coming out, amen? They walked 40 years in the wilderness till all who were men of war who came out of Egypt perished, because they did not hearken to the voice of the Lord. To them the Lord swore that he would not let them see the land, which the Lord swore to their forefathers to give us, a land flowing in milk and honey. So it was their uncircumcised children, whom he raised up in their stead, whom Joshua circumcised, because the rite had not been performed on the way. And when they finished circumcising all the males of the nation, they remained in their places. They were quarantined. They remained in their places in the camp until they were healed. Woo! Do you see this, saints of God? They had the circumcision and they didn't run to battle. They didn't take Jericho on. They stayed in quarantine until they were healed. And God is saying that y'all are getting a spiritual healing in this quarantine at this time of Passover, that you're getting deliverance. Woo! In Jesus' name. And the Israelites, and the Lord said to Joshua, verse 9, this day I have rolled away the reproach of Egypt. Woo! Do you understand that Egypt was on the children that were born in the wilderness? They had not been in Egypt. Who had been in Egypt? Their parents. Their parents spoke the message of Egypt. Fear. All these things. You don't know what's going to happen. We don't get the food that we need. We need to get more food. We need to do this. We need to do that. Do you understand? They were still slaves in Egypt. Their soul was still in Egypt. Do you understand, saints of God? And this is their children that have never been in Egypt. But here, this is where that God says that there was still a reproach of Egypt on the children. Do you see the saints of God? And that represents sin. So listen, look at verse 9 again. And the Lord said to Joshua, this day, woo! This day have I rolled away the reproach of Egypt from you. So the name of the place was called Gilgal, rolling to this day. And Gilgal actually means reproach. And we're going to look particularly at that Greek, at that Hebrew word of Joshua 5, verse 9. So let's look at Gilgal. And it actually means a wheel. It indicates something that's turning. It means reproach. So Gilgal here in Hebrew is the word. It just sounds exactly like I pronounced it. Gilgal. It means a wheel that is rolling away. It is the same of this particular word that sounds exactly very similar. Gilgal. And Gilgal means a wheel. That actually means a wheel. It is used in Isaiah 28, 28. Why is 28 so important? Because 28 means to purify. It means to purge of pride. Woo! I've written a note on it. God had me write a note on it not too long ago. 28 means to purge of pride. So listen to Isaiah 28, 28. Because this root word is only used one time in Scripture, Gilgal. And it means, and it says, Isaiah 28, 28 says, bread corn is bruised because he will not ever be threshing it, nor break it with the wheel of his cart, nor bruise it with the horsemen. So let's look at this scripture in context, and then we're going to go back over to Joshua 5, amen? So let's look at Joshua 5, and let's look at verse 26. And what we see is the discretion of the Lord about your threshing floor. Oh my goodness. This is the last message that I preached. Go to the last Facebook Live. I just preached about the threshing floor and the wild ox on the threshing floor. And so Isaiah 28, 28 is our threshing floor. It is our circumcision. It's our Gilgal. Woo! It's the wheel. Amen. And so let's look at verse 26 and Isaiah 28. And in fact, I'm going to go ahead and pull it up as well in the Amplified Classic, just so I have that text as well, that translation. So Isaiah 28. And Isaiah 28 is God mad, angry at the contempt of his people in pride, and especially the priest. He's really dealing with his people in pride. Isaiah 28 is that. So let's look at verse 26. Verse 26. And he trains each of them correctly. For his God instructs him correctly and teaches him. Isaiah is actually giving this word with verse 23 being the beginning about the message that comes from the Lord of hosts. In fact, let's look at verse 22. In order to lead up to verse 28, so that we get the scripture in context and get more meat, more understanding, amen? So verse 22 says, now therefore, do not be scoffers, lest the bands which bind you, lest your own stronghold. Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. Well, in fact, we're going to go to verse 21. And the reason we're going to go to verse 21, oh my goodness, is because of what is actually going on in this scripture. It is so amazing. So let's look at Isaiah 28. And I'm also going to get, I'm getting the Hebrew word up for this particular chapter, Isaiah 28, verse 21. And we're going to see particularly when the Lord is rising up. Amen. And so right here in Isaiah 28, verse 21, for the Lord will rise up as on Mount Perazim. He will be wrathful as in the valley of Gibeon. He's about to deal with your stronghold. That he may do his work, his strange work, his wonderful work. and bring to pass his act, his strange act, something that they had never seen, and that's why it's so strange. Now, therefore, do not be scoffers. And this is where the hindrance of bitterness, that hindering spirit, can operate, is in a scoffing tone. So listen to verse 22, because God is going to remove that hindrance, amen. Now, therefore, do not be scoffers, lest the bands that bind you be made strong. In other words, God is saying, do not be given over to these issues. In other words, that you will not be in more bondage. God is dealing with your bondage. Is that not phenomenal, saints of God? He is dealing with your bondage, and he is saying, look, if you want deliverance, you need to be delivered from this scoffing spirit, from this hindrance, from fear that is causing doubt and unbelief. Because if you don't, guess what? Your bands are going to get stronger. I know. Is that not incredible, Renee? I'm just wanting to get up and run around the apartment. This is phenomenal teaching. Oh, my goodness. For a decree of destruction have I heard from the Lord God of hosts upon the whole land and the whole earth. You have to understand, the whole purpose of the Lord of hosts is to carry the message. So anywhere in Scripture where you see the visitation of the Lord of hosts, it's all about the message. And the message has power. And the message has deliverance. And the prophet is saying, listen, the Lord of hosts, the one that I met in Isaiah 6, that Lord of hosts, he's coming to you, and he's coming in power. And he's about to visit, and he is going to destroy the works of the devil. Woo! Now here it is in verse 23. Give ear and hear my voice. This is Isaiah. Listen and hear my words. Does he who plows for sowing plow continually? Does he who continue to plow and harrow the ground after it is smooth? When he has leveled its surface, does he not cast abroad the seed, the fennel, the dill, the scat, and scatter the cumin, a seasoning, and put the wheat and rose and barley as it is intended in place and spelt? At the border, and he who trains each of them correctly, for his God instructs him correctly and teaches him. For deal is not threshed with a sharp threshing instrument, nor is a cart wheel, this is where Gilgal is coming in, rolled over cumin, but deal is beaten off with staff and cumin with a rod. Does one crush bread grain? No, he doesn't thresh it continually. Woo! Oh my goodness, do you understand? A bruised reed, he will not break. A bruised reed, he will not break. This is the prophecy of Messiah in Isaiah 42:3. It's also in Matthew 12:20 in Scripture. A bruised reed, and you know what verse chapter 12 is in Matthew 12 is? It is all about deliverance from the strong man. Woo! Deliverance from the strong man. That you bind the strong man up first, and then you empty his house of his equipment. And God is bringing us through this symbolism that we're seeing in Joshua, in Isaiah 28. He is showing you your soul. And he's showing you all the seed. And he's saying, look, I've plowed in your soul, and I've brought the seed, but I'm not going to keep beating and plowing. What you need to find out is about to mature. The seed is going to grow. It's going to hit 100-fold, and you're about to see deliverance. You're about to see Rhema. And God is saying, he's not going to break you. He is going to bring you into freedom. He is going to bind up your broken heart. Amen. Let's look at verse 28 again. Does one crush bread grain? No. He does not thresh it continuously. In other words, your address is not going to be the threshing floor. You're getting a new address. Your address is not going to be the wilderness. It's not going to be a quarantine. Your address is about to be the promised land. Woo! It's about to be freedom. It's about to be liberty. It's about to be healing, deliverance. Hallelujah. Woo! In Jesus' name. But when he has driven his cartwheel and his horses over it, that word is Gilgal, which is where Gilgal comes from. But when he has ridden Gilgal over it, in other words, you've been on the threshing floor long enough, guess what's arrived at your address? Woo! A wheel. Gilgal, remove the reproach. A cartwheel and horses over it, he scatters and tosses up to the wind without having crushed it. Do you understand? Glory to God that your threshing floor is where the seed multiplied. Woo! Because when that wheat is threshed, guess what's all in there? You've got you some seed, hallelujah. And he throws it up in the air and he blows the seed and it's not crushed. Woo! A bruised reed he will not break. Let me get to this scripture. It's Matthew 12. Oh my goodness. God is doing so much. Oh my goodness. Because now I've taught on Matthew 12 a gazillion times. And he continually brings, amen, Andrea. And he continually brings me back to Matthew 12. So let's look at Matthew 12, verse 20. This is a prophecy from Isaiah 42, 3. A bruised reed he will not break, and a smoldering, dimly wick he will not quench, till he brings justice and a just cause to victory. Hallelujah. And in and on his name, with the Gentiles, the people outside of Israel, set their hope. I'm telling you, saints of God, it is about the hope of Christ in you. Now let's return to Joshua 5, amen. And we're going to also look at the Hebrew letters for Gilgal, and then we're going to get into communion, amen. So let's look at verse 6. Let's look at verse 9 again. And the Lord said to Joshua, this day have I rolled away the reproach of Egypt from you. So the name of the place is called Gilgal, rolling to this day. And the Israelites did camp in Gilgal, and they kept, oh my goodness, what? Oh my goodness. They remained in Gilgal, and they kept Passover. What? On the 14th day, oh my goodness, of the months in the plains of Jericho. Is this not crazy? Because I did not know that Passover was there. My brain just did not click with it. And I've taught on Joshua 5 a gazillion times. And it says they got healed. He removed away the reproach. And then they had Passover. What? At Gilgal. Oh my goodness. This is totally Holy Spirit. God is causing us. I know, Jenny, is that not crazy? Does that not make you want to run? God is causing us to have. I know, Samantha. Andrea, no. God is causing us to have a true Passover. Woo! I'm telling you, saints of God, he's going to deliver you. If you've been oppressed, if there's been a strong man, I command it now to be exposed to the light. And I declare, like God's word says, that you have let go of bitterness. And in your heart, if you need to, say, Father God, forgive me for bitterness. I forgive. I let go of whoever I've held on to, of what anger I've held, of what resentment I've held. I let go, Father God, because Jesus took care of it at the cross. He took care of it at the cross. I put it at the cross today. I give it to you, and I take Jesus. I take his work. I take what he has done for me today. Hallelujah. And so it's here at the cross. Woo! Oh my goodness. Because this you're going to love. And Perazim means breaches, to break. It's breaker. So when we look at that Isaiah 28, It means to break forth. It means covering a gap. Oh my goodness. God is about to break forth in your gap, in your soul, where you've been fragmented, where you have been in bondage. God is about to break forth by Holy Spirit, by the Word, by the truth, and you're going to be set free. You're entering Passover because He's removed away the reproach at the cross of Christ. Hallelujah. And let's look at, as we end here, let's look at, glory to God, Gilgal, the Hebrew letters. I think it's Gamil Lamed, Gamil Lamed. It is. Gamil Lamed, Gamil Lamed. Now watch this. Woo! Watch this. Gamil, G-A-M-I-L, is a camel. And it means to be lifted up. Or either it means pride. What? And then Lamed, L-A-M-E-D, is the tongue. And it means control, authority. And it also means to open. Tongue control and authority and open. But watch this. Because this word Gilgal is Gamil Lamed, Gamil Lamed. In other words, Gamil Lamed. And so when we look at this Hebrew word with two Gamils and two Lameds, watch this. Where pride has been exalted in the tongue and it's controlled us, God has now lifted up. Who's He lifted up? His Son. Woo! On the cross, right? He's lifted His Son up. Woo! For His Son to bring you His authority. Oh my goodness! Does that not make you want to run? Where pride has exalted itself. That is 2 Corinthians 10. Where pride has exalted itself through our tongue, God has lifted up His Son. Hallelujah. To bring us His authority, and that brings deliverance. That brings freedom. So I just pray that God brings you healing. He brings you deliverance as we get ready to take communion. I just declare the sword of God's word. It cuts the cords of the strong man that has been binding you. And it is totally bound up and cannot operate. And I command it to loose you and go into the wilderness in the name of Jesus Christ. And I declare Matthew 3, 11 and 12, the baptism of Holy Spirit and fire. Woo! Be on you, hallelujah. Yay, God, hallelujah. Baptize your people in Holy Spirit and fire, God, and bring your fire to burn the chaff. And yay, God, that you bring in your wheat. Woo! Hallelujah. You bring in your wheat because you thoroughly clear out. Woo! Your threshing floor. That's Matthew 3, 11, and 12. That is the baptism, oh my goodness, of Holy Spirit and fire that we just went through. Woo! In Isaiah 28. Hallelujah. I just speak that over you in Jesus' name. Woo! And now we enter communion. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. And I love this bread because it represents the stripes that Jesus Christ took for us. Amen, Sherry. It represents the beating that He took. And it reminds us that He gave His body and He offered it and He sacrificed Himself. He was the first seed that was sown into the ground. And if one seed dies and it multiplies to many, He has brought in sons and daughters to the kingdom. So God, in remembrance of Jesus Christ, we now break this bread and we take it and we lift it up as Christ on the cross. Hallelujah. We lift up your Son. Hallelujah. We lift up your word. And we say, God, today, let this be a special Passover. Let this be a Gilgal, a real heart transplant in me, Father, so that I can know your heart, your intentions through the mind of Christ. And I do this in remembrance of Jesus. And God, we lift up the grape of the vine. We lift this up, Father, and we acknowledge the blood of Jesus Christ that was poured out at the cross, over the cross, where he nailed our sins to the cross, God. He bled all over Jerusalem. He bled in the courtroom of the enemy. And God, that we are no longer in the courtroom of the enemy, as in 1 Corinthians 2:13 and 14, our spirit is to be judged by no one, for we are new creatures in Christ. And so, God, we acknowledge the blood of Jesus, and we take this in remembrance of what he has done for us at this time of Passover. And God, we just thank you that you have brought us into your surgery room. And you are transplanting in us the very heart of your Son, Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. I love you. And I pray you have an awesome holiday. You have an awesome feast. And I just pray you enter into this time with dancing and joy. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. I love you. I'll see you on Friday, Resurrection Day.